Thank you, precious God. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Amen. I was going to give you something to lighten you up. God's presence. You see, the church is not, it's a kind of field today. But it's not the first time. Listen to this. This is about overcrowded church. So this church, this was about 2,000 member church. It was filled to overflowing capacity on one Sunday. The preacher was ready to start the sermon when two men dressed in long black coat with sunglasses, black hats, they entered through the rear of the building. One of the men walked to the middle of the church while the other stayed in the back of the church. They both then reached under their coats and withdrew automatic weapons in the church. You get the picture? The one in the middle of the church then announced, "Everyone willing to take a bullet for Jesus, stay on your seat." Naturally, what do you think will happen? The church emptied quickly. People started exiting so fast. But you know, the pastor was still on the pulpit, so he stood there. And when it was most of the deacons, you know, they stayed because the pastor was staying. So they don't want the deacon cooling on out. And interestingly, the choir director too stayed. Hallelujah. After a few minutes, there were about 20 people left in the church. Then the men put their weapon in and said gently to the pastor, "All right, sir. Pastor, the hypocrites are gone. Let's get on with the service." So let's get on with the service this afternoon. Hallelujah. Amen. This month of July is a unique month. Hallelujah. As we started during the night vigil, God said, this month is the month of faithfulness. Faithfulness. Last month was the month of prayers, and we praise God. But this, starting from today, we are going to be looking at the word faithfulness. Hallelujah. And I believe that by the time this month is over, your basket of testimony in the area of faithfulness will have, you know, be spilling over in the name of Jesus. I said you will experience the faithfulness of God this month in everything you lay your hands on in Jesus' name. What is faithfulness? What is faithfulness? Merriam-Webster Dictionary gave about five definitions of faithfulness. One of them is an obsolete definition, that faithfulness simply means full of faith. Faithful. Another definition was that of being steadfast in affection or allegiance. And that simply talks about loyalty. To be faithful is to be loyal. The third one is firm adherence to promises or in the observance of duty. That you will always show up at your duty post at the time you are required to be there and you stay there. And that simply means you are conscientious. Number four, it talks about giving with a strong assurance that you bind yourself. Yesterday I was talking with House Fellowship teachers, and we were looking at Paul calling himself a bond servant. In the book of Romans, Paul said, "I am the bond servant of Jesus Christ." And I was asking them, I said, "What does it mean to be a bond servant?" The New Testament says we are no more servants. Jesus said, "You are no more slaves. You are not servants, but you are now my friends. We are now children of God." But Paul said, he was a born servant of Jesus Christ. Even though he's a child of God, he has binded himself as an act of his own will to carry out the mission of Jesus Christ with the last breath in him. That is what it means to bond yourself. So this faithfulness is binding. To be faithful is to have a binding resolution to something. Hallelujah. It also means to be true to facts, to be true to a standard, that you don't change your standard, irrespective of whatever is happening around you. And it also means to be an original. And I said during the night meeting that none of us is a duplicate. There's no duplicate child of God. We are all original. Masterpiece original. And I said, there are no two of you. There is no voice like your voice in all the universe. Hallelujah. You know, in English language, there's something they call the synonyms. So what are the synonyms of faithfulness? It means to be constant, to be dedicated, to be devoted, to be good, to be loyal, to be steadfast, to be steady, not shaky, to be true, to be a staunch believer in something or supporter of something, and to be resolute. That you have made a choice to serve God, come rain, come sunshine, you are not going to abandon, turn your back on Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. In Hebrew language, the word translated faithfulness, if you read the Old Testament, is the word A-M-A-N. Somebody said that's Aman, whatever they call it. And the primary meaning of this word is that of providing stability and confidence. So a faithful person is a stable person. Is somebody that has confidence, or somebody that you can put your confidence in. There are many people in churches today, you can't put your confidence in them. Because when you need them most, that is when they will turn their back on you. Hallelujah. But the Bible says there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And that's Jesus. So he is faithful. He is stable. And you can put your confidence in him. Hallelujah. In the Greek language, if you read the old New Testament, the word faithfulness is the word pistos. It means to be worthy of belief, to be worthy of trust, and to see the word again, confidence. In all this, why are we looking at this? This word conveys the notion of reliability and trustworthiness. And God is both of these. God is reliable. That's why we sing this song. Reliable, reliable God. Reliable, reliable God. So God is reliable. You can count on it. And in the night vigil, I said, since God created heaven and earth, that daytime and night season has never missed it, because he is reliable. I said, what will happen if tomorrow there's no day? Everything just remains dark. Hallelujah. But there is one called Jesus. And the Bible says he upholds all things by the word of his power. He doesn't fail. Hallelujah. And God is trustworthy. He said, there's no one that calls upon the name of the Lord that will be disappointed. You can count on God. And I use the language of pull betters. And I said, it even amazes me that, you know, when I moved from US to Canada and I go to gas stations to buy gas, I begin to wonder, is it a requirement that when you buy gas, you must play lotto? Because it's almost everybody that comes to buy gas that play lotto. And I was wondering, what kind of country is this? That young men, old men, women, all gender, they just play lotto as part of buying gas. So I use a term that we use back in Africa in those days, that when you are staking, you don't farm 3 from 5. You know how they do it. When I was serving my country after my university education, they posted me to the northern part of Nigeria. And during the weekends, there was a pool shop around where I live. And the owner would come and call us, please, call us, come and help me. Because you see people lining up, queuing up. They want to nap it Friday before the thing goes. And that was where I learned most of the languages. But I can confidently tell you I don't play it. I never play it. I never put my money in it. Because it's not a Christian, even though I wasn't a Christian then. So you can knock your life on Jesus. You can knock your life, buy your life on the word of God, and it will. never fail you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So God is a God of faithfulness. He is reliable and he is trustworthy. Hallelujah. And now this is where the rubber meets the road. God demands that you and I be faithful. God is faithful. Nobody has any question about that. But do you know that God is holding us to the same standard? That if you are my child, you carry my DNA, then you have to be faithful. Because the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 2, the Bible says it is required in steward that one be found faithful. It's a requirement. And for those of us that have gone through college education and university education, you know there are some courses they call required courses. You never graduate until you fully satisfy those required classes. You will never get a reward in heaven. No tangible reward until you pass this test of faithfulness in the school of reward in heaven. God demands that we be found faithful. God demands that you be found reliable. God demands that you be held accountable to the words you have spoken. You have given people your word and you don't fulfill it. Mm-mm. God will hold you accountable because we are the seed of God. We are the children of God. We have his DNA in us. Hallelujah. So our text briefly for this week's study is Matthew chapter 25. So please flow with me. Matthew 25, 14 to 30. Matthew 25, 14 to what? Hallelujah. And I'm going to be shuffling between the King James and the Amplified. So for the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, and who called his own servants, and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2 talents, to one, to another one talent. But to every man according to his several ability, and straightway he took his journey. The King James Version put it that the Amplified Version said, He gave to each in proportion to his own personal ability. Then he departed and left the country. That means the one he gave 5 to, the master knew he could handle 5. So he gave him based on his ability and capability. The one he gave 2 to, he gave him because he knows this one can handle only 2. If he gives him 3, he's gonna kill him. And the one he gave 1 to, he knew that that was what all he could handle. God is our master. He is our father. He is our maker. He knows what you can handle in life. He knows how many talents you can handle. And he has given you enough talent to last you a lifetime. Hallelujah. 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 Let's keep reading. So he who has received then verse 16. Then he that has received the 5 talents went and traded with the same, and made 5 talents more. And likewise, he that has received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that has received 1 went and dig in the earth and hid the Lord's money. Hallelujah. Now, after a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled account with them. That's why I said God is holding us accountable. But look at how this unfolded. And he who had received the 5 talents came and brought with him 5 more, saying, Master, you entrusted to me 5 talents. See, here I have gained 5 talents more. Verse 21, his master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You see the word faithful? Good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. That Amplified said, enter into and share the joy, the delight and the blessedness which your master enjoys. Then he who has received 2 came and said, Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said to him the same word, well done, you upright, honorable, and admirable, and faithful servant. You have been faithful and trustworthy over a little. I will put you in charge of all. Enter into and share the joy, the delight, the blessedness which your master enjoys. Verse 24. Then he which has received 1 talent came and said, Lord, I'll picture myself what kind of dominion he had. His countenance, squeezing his face. Lord, I knew you that by hard man. You reap where you don't sow. You are an exploiter. You gather where you have not planted. And I was afraid. And so I went and I hid the talent in the earth. Lo, see, this is it. Take your stuff. But his master answered him, you wicked and lazy and idle servant. Did you indeed know that I reap where I have not sowed? I gather grain where I have not winnowed? Then, if indeed you know, then you should have invested my money or my gift or my ability or my talent with the bankers. Put it to work. And at my coming, I will have what? I will have received what is my own with interest. So everything God has given you, God is expecting you to profit. And there's going to be a day of reckoning to see how well you have done with what he has blessed you with. So he said, verse 27, so take the talent away from him and give to the one who has 10 talents. Why not the one that has 4? You will see. For to everyone who has, more will be given. And he will what? He shall have abundance. But from him that has not, shall be taken away even that which he has, and cast the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There will be weeping and grinding of teeth. That's eternal damnation. That's why I said there will be no reward if we are not found faithful. Now, quickly, because of time, let's look at a number of things and we'll see how far we can go today. Hallelujah. In verses 14 to 15, the 14 to 15 verse of that scripture, I have a couple of things I want to point your attention to there. Matthew 25. He said, for the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servant and delivered to them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2 talents, to another 1, to every man according to his several ability. And straightway he took his journey. The first thing that was clear from that scripture, that parable that Jesus told, was that all of us, we have been entrusted with God's goods. There is nobody that has not been given something. There's none of us. Many times we know, I can't sing, I can't play. I've spoken to people and then I've had things like, I can't do anything, I'm just useless, I can't do anything. No. There's nobody useless in the kingdom of God. There is at least something you can do in the body of Christ that will benefit and enhance the operation of the body of Christ. Some of us have different abilities. For months, I have cried to the Lord for somebody that has a passion for photography. That just like to take photos and can do a lot of things with photographs. Hallelujah. And today, Brother Jibola was just talking, and he said he likes to take pictures. And I saw him in church, he would just be snapping, he has his own camera, just take pictures. I said, Lord, thank you for answers to prayer. Because gradually God is building the body. Hallelujah. So there is none of us, we have at least a talent or an ability, or you have at least a grace. Some of us are good in our administration. Some of us are technical, ideas. Some of us can sing. Some of us can play drums. Some of us can abilities. You see, some graces were given to us when we were born. There are some people, they can just run. They know how to run. They are so fast on their feet. They didn't learn it, they were born with it. Some people, they are just sing. They can just sing, they flow with songs, they can pick the notes. They were born with it. Some graces were given to us when we were born. Some were given to us when we got born again. And as we keep on serving God, some other graces will be given to us. For example, take Paul. He was a good speaker in the natural world before he became converted. He was a professor, he was a teacher. But when he was converted, the gift of teacher, of a teacher, spiritual teacher, there's difference from natural teacher and spiritual teacher. What was given to him, and also the gift of a prophet to speak the mind of God. And as he kept serving God, another grace to be an apostle, a special messenger with a special message to the nations of the world. He was called into that office and he operated there. So that is another ability. And we thank God that Paul, to the last breath, he faithfully put into practice all the graces of God upon his life. He was not a back woman sitting in the back. He was always in the front, even at the peril of his life. Hallelujah. So those endowments, they are given to according to our individual ability. Why didn't God give Peter all the gifts he gave Paul? Because Peter couldn't handle it. Why didn't he give Bartholomew or somebody around them? They couldn't handle it. But Paul has been prepared by God to be able to stand. He knows he can stand before learned people. He has the mental ability. He was almost also God privileged him to be a Roman citizen. In those days, if you are not a Roman citizen, your movement will be restricted. Just like in the time of segregation. I will say, oh, this place for whites only, this place for blacks. So God allowed Paul to be born in Tarsus. He has a Roman citizenship. That means he can move anywhere in the world. And he was educated by the best of the best, but he never knew his purpose until the one that created him revealed himself to him and said, this is your purpose. You are to take my name to Rome. Peter couldn't do it. Because Peter lived with Jesus. They saw Jesus physically. So they became limited. They only knew Jesus in the flesh. They ate with him. They slept in the same room. They couldn't see the spiritual side of Jesus. So God has to call somebody that never met Jesus Christ in person. Somebody that can only see the spiritual side of Jesus Christ. To reveal to us all the wealth of knowledge in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And Peter said, these things are hard to believe, but they are scriptures. Hallelujah. So where you are, what God has given you, it is what he has prepared you, is what he created you to do. But are you doing it? Are you faithful in what he has put in you? Are you faithful? You have a good voice, and every Sunday you look at the choir, and you can't say, Pastor, I'm going to be singing. I believe I can sing. Are you faithful? If you are still waiting for somebody to come and call you and beg you before you begin to serve God, then there is a day of reckoning. God will ask you what you have done with your gift. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In verses 16 to 19, on this I will stop. We saw that in the account, they said, after a while, the master returned to settle accounts. So that means God expects us to do something with what he has given us. Hallelujah. But two of them got the same reward. Two of them, the one he gave five, made five more, 100%. Mathematician, that's 100%. The one he gave two, made how many more? Two more, that's 100%. But they got the same reward. Faithful, good and faithful servant, I will make you ruler of many. Enter into the joy or the blessedness of your Lord. So please, I want you to know that God does not reward who reward it quantity. Not neither does God reward size. God rewards faithfulness. As a pastor, if he has called me to be a pastor over 100 people, I don't need to compare myself with somebody that's called to be a pastor over 2,000. If I am faithful in pastoring 100 people, I will receive the best reward from heaven. The one that is pastoring 2,000, if he's not faithfully doing it, he will have no reward. Because God rewards faithfulness, not the size. Many pastors are speaking to pastors, and most of the things they focus on is how many people you touch. And I keep telling them, it's not the number of people you touch, it is the quality of the people you have in your church. What have you done with them? Many months ago, I was praying to the Lord. When we were still in the Lord, you said that this will be a big church. Where are the people? Lord, send the people. Just send them, brothers and sisters that are fervent, those who have betrayed, those who have not said, stop asking me that stupid question. He said, the five people have given you, what have you done with them? If you transform them, what everything you know about me and everything I will show you, if you pour it into them, those ones will be the ones that will attract to us. So men will follow them to your church if you are faithful in the five I've given you. So I stopped praying for God to send people that are prepared somewhere. Because that is like taking the brick from another place. Somebody already built the house, and you are now pulling the bricks and building your own house, and you can't do that. And God said, I will send you raw materials, people that are raw. Many of them will be with their past to be so terrible. But if you faithfully minister to them, the church, you will experience my hand. And so we change our prayer focus. Lord, send you people. It doesn't matter what their past is. We will receive them. We will minister to them. Drug addicts, people that have been written off by society, send them here. Faithfulness is important. Because those people need God. Take for example, Brother Wale. The day we met his wife was laughing at Wale in the church. But the guy remained here. And he's growing with the Lord. If I don't call him, he will call me every day. For over a month, for almost 2 months now. That is faithfulness. The day he came, I could have, if my focus has been, oh Lord, is this brother going to be here? Is he going to stay? I would have been trying to cajole him to stay here. Don't do that. God will send whatever you need to make it in life. If you are faithful in what God has given you, He will add to you what you need. Yes. Hallelujah. Yeah. God does not reward what quantity, He rewards size. Hallelujah. Yeah. Jesus is Lord. I think I have to stop here. I wish I could just finish this, but today is Holy Communion and the anointing service, and those things are important. We are not going to heaven yet. Are we going to heaven yet? Is there anybody who is 120 years old? So we'll still be here next week. So let's digest it, let's take it easy while they bring in the Holy Communion. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.